Bibles to John chapter 1. We'll be starting in verse 11. John chapter 1, starting in verse 11. We're going to continue this message series called The Family Message Series and just talk about different aspects of what can bind us together, unite us together. I mean, what a week we have had as a nation, as Robertson County, as just people. And so The Family Message Series started last week just to remind us of some wonderful things to unite us as a family of God, to be able to accomplish our mission as a family of God. And today we're going to be talking about adoption. Adoption into the family of God for reasons that you'll never regret. For reasons you'll never regret. If you are a Christ-filled believer here, you've been adopted. Adoption is not just for orphans or people without biological moms or dads or absent biological moms or dads. Adoption is also for you and I into God's family. John chapter 1, starting in verse 11. If you would, let's all please stand in honor of reading the Lord's word, if you're able to this morning. John chapter 1, and I'll tell you what, I'm going to back up to verse 9. It's not up on the screen, but I'm going to back up to verse 9. So if you've got your word with me, just rewind to verse 9 with me. John chapter 1, starting in verse 9. There was the true light, which coming into the world enlightens every man. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him. Verse 11, our focus passage today. He came to his own, and those who were his own did not receive him. But as many received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God, even to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor the will of flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. Let's pray. Father, we love you. And God, thank you for this honor to be able to come together to hear your word publicly read. God, we thank you that we have this honor and this privilege and this freedom. God, we thank you for our faith family. That again, we are not promised, we are not worthy nor deserving, but God, you've given us a faith family so we don't have to do life alone, but we can do life together with a group of people in the same way, same manner. God, with the same mission. Father, thank you. Lord, thank you for your plan. God, help us to become the men and women that you would have us be so that we can accomplish the Great Commission and heart of the Great Commandment throughout Robertson County and beyond. Lord, we love you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray in. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Oh, how wonderful it is to be wanted by a family. When a little boy or a little girl are adopted, that family is reaffirming to that child, we want you and we love you. What a wonderful, wonderful feeling that some children struggle with and struggle with and struggle with until that day of adoption occurs. And just like you and I, before God, running amok, before God, sons and daughters of disobedience, before God, we are slaves to our sin. But then the day of adoption occurs. And what a day it is for you and I to be adopted in love and projected that we are wanted. We have purpose and reason to live. How many more people we've got in our world, in our family, and in our community that struggles right there. It struggles with that. Woo, wouldn't you want to be a community? Wouldn't you want to be a faith family? Wouldn't you want to be a church family that when these people come into this building struggling and hurting and alone and broken, they do not leave isolated anymore. They do not leave as if they are needing a family anymore. But it is well known when they walk up into our group, woo, then that they are loved, that they are wanted. Don't you know we all need something like that, don't we? So isolating to do life alone. And so many people, it takes so much effort and so much pride swallowing at times into so much of their life to put behind them just to step into the doors of a church. What do we have waiting for them? We are adopted into the family of God for mission, not safety. For mission, not comfort. For mission, not pleasure. For mission and not selfish reasons, but for mission and mission alone. You and I are at this table, at this family, for a reason. You'll never, ever regret that. If you are on mission, and if you are serving this community, your family, your business, your church, the way that God has called you to do it, you'll never regret it. Verse 11 says, he came to his own, and those who were his own, they didn't receive him. This verse, verse 11, it's interesting to note that St. Augustine, this was the verse, the main verse for his conversion. It's that powerful of a verse. But there's a tragedy here that is found in this verse, and it's a deep, deep tragedy. He did not come as an outsider. Jesus came as one who already belonged, and they still rejected him. He came as somebody that was already apart. From family that was already apart. From a nation that was already apart, and they rejected him. He wasn't a stranger from strange people, from a strange land. And even at that, they should not have rejected him. But he looked like them, he talked like them, from the same family, same height, same everything, and they still rejected him. The tragedy deepens and deepens and deepens. He welcomes you and I while he himself got a door slammed in his face. Got a door slammed right into his face. The word receive here means to receive with favor. It implies welcome. Welcome. Have you ever seen a pineapple on a door? Anybody here have a pineapple sign, symbol, image on their door? No, am I really talking out of my head right now? I know I've seen this. Yeah, right? I mean, we got a few. We got a few. Well, when I first saw it, I saw these things, and it just reminded me of how hungry I was. And I hated seeing it because I'm like, there's food on a door. Now I'm going to go talk and I'm hungry. And I'm always hungry. Well, then I come to find out that that pineapple is a sign of what? What? I can't hear you. Welcome. I can't hear you. I hear words. There you go. Hospitality. Somebody enunciated. That was wonderful. I can't read your lips. Yeah. That's right. If you could turn to the book of Bubba, I can't understand the words coming out of your mouth. There's a problem that arose. Adoption had these problems. He welcomed us, right? And so we, even when we weren't a part of his family, he welcomed us. How much more so should we welcome people into our life? This past week and past couple weeks, my wife and I have had the honor of having a kitchen fixed and stuff. So a couple months ago, our dishwasher exploded, some of you guys know, and our insurance took care of us and said, man, just get it fixed, that kind of thing. And so we had this crew come in, and I knew there were going to be people coming into my home that I did not know. And I tell you what, for an evangelist, there's a joy right there because all these people are just lining up to get my house, and they're going to hear the gospel. They're going to hear something about Jesus, and I ain't got to burn gas to do it. It's wonderful, wonderful. And I've made some friends, I think. They were very friendly, you know, very kind, and I absolutely loved it. Loved it. Didn't have to go anywhere. But I try to make them feel welcome, right? I try to make them feel hospitable. Man, I'm giving out cold drinks. I'm cooking lunch. I'm doing whatever I can to make sure that when they leave my home, they're like, man, we're going to miss that place. We're going to miss that place. But isn't that what church ought to be like too? But man, how many people, though, have that where they go into churches and people are not welcoming? They don't extend that. They don't love them. They don't let them know, man, I'd love to see you back. I want to pray with you and pray for you. We've had a great number of guests in this service in the past several weeks. And we want to make sure that you know that you are loved, that God loves you even more infinitely than we can even love you. But you are oh so welcome to be here. You are oh so welcome to be a part of this family, this church family, so that we can carry out the accomplished mission of Jesus Christ. You are so welcome to be here. But so many struggle. He welcomes us, only for us at times to turn our back on even our community, our family, or even people that come here. That don't sound right, does it? It sounds like the unfaithful servant in the Bible. that the king pardoned and gave much grace to, but then when he went out, he didn't extend grace to everybody else. And when the king heard about it, the king said, "Now listen, I gave you grace, and you turned around and didn't give grace to them? Get out of here, you unfaithful servant, unfaithful servant." In verse 11, we see a very, very huge, huge aspect here in verse 11. Let me read it again, and we've got to get this. He came to his, what's that word? Own. And those who were not, and those who were his did not receive him. We see this word own, and this is one of the problems that we have in our English translation, is that we can't get the fullness of what is going on here and what John is trying to communicate. But there are these different kind of moods, personality kind of tenses that we have with the same exact word, own. See, the very first time that it mentions own, he came to his own, that's a neuter. The tense there is neuter. And then those who were not, and those that were his own, it turns into a masculine word. You're like, why should I care? What does that even matter? I barely passed English. I don't care. Why do I care about that? David, why don't you just read it straight and tell it to us straight? I am trying to tell it to you straight. What John was trying to emphatically tell his audience by just the tenses of the word was that Jesus came to his own, neuter. What that means was that they weren't about themselves. They were about something that was not of gender, which is of God. They were focused on God. But then when he came and they rejected him, how did they reject him? Well, the word becomes masculine. Why? Because then they start becoming more about themselves. It takes on a personhood. What we see here, very short and simple, is that when Jesus came, the way that they rejected him was not to focus on him anymore, not to be a part of him anymore, but to be a part of sin and self and me. That was the power that allowed them to reject him. John is trying to do this in a very cool, smooth way to his audience by just changing a little bit of that tense right there, just to earmark that something happened. Something changed. Something is no longer like it once was. They once were people that were of him. And then they changed. Same group of people. They changed into a people that were about themselves. They're about all themselves. See, he is either the ruler or he allows us to own it and rule it. He is either the ruler of the things of your life, therefore you're the first own. Or he allows you to rule and own it on your own. You're the second own. And it's in that lifestyle that we begin to reject Jesus Christ. That we begin to do that. Sometimes some of us have this mindset that once we get into certain places in the community or certain committees or things in the church or certain places of power, that finally we've come and we can rule and we can change and we can tell people how it's to be done. See, within the church, which is where I have to focus, where I do focus, we're not here to rule over one another. We're not here to control one another. Control in the Bible, Galatians 5:22 says that we are to be self-controlled and controlled by the Spirit. We don't come to this place to control or rule or tell everybody else and dictate to everybody else what to do. Why? Because that's toxic tyranny. As a group of people, we covenant together, we mission together as a group of people to accomplish the same mission. But inevitably, in any kind of organization, in any kind of group, there are some people that just don't get it. There are some times that just doesn't happen. And we get in these places where we want to tell everybody what to do. That's toxic, and that's tyranny. God's rule is this, that we as a people, just church, let's not talk about other organizations, just as a church, we are called to be self-controlled and to be controlled of the Holy Spirit, encouraging other people, not controlling, not dictating, allowing him to rule and not one of us to rule. The moment that one of us begin to rule is the moment we become toxic and it becomes a tyranny. And it fails, and we become the second own, and we reject him. And he will leave this place and just scrap Springfield Baptist off the church sign and call it Ichabod Baptist Church, because the Spirit will depart from that kind of organization. We are adopted into the family for mission to reach all people. To reach all people, not just some, not just some. But why keeps us from it? What keeps you and I from doing that kind of thing? Well, let me ask you this, just straightforward. When's the last time you shared the gospel with somebody? You, not me. Don't look at me. You, as an individual. Well, I don't know when the last time my church, I'm not talking about your church. I'm talking about you. Because that's the mission that we're called to do. We're called to let people know about his glory and about how wonderful Jesus is and that they could be a part of his family. When was the last time that you did that? Well, if you're having a hard time thinking about that last time, let me tell you why it's been that long. Because of sin. Right there. There's sin in your way. There's sin mastering you. There's something keeping you away from the greatest thing of all greatest things. From the thing that matters beyond all eternity. And that is Jesus Christ. Us knowing him and telling others about who he is and how wonderful he is. That's what we're called to do. Now, David, you're the ones called to do that. You got that personality, right? You got that personality. It's your job. That's why we pay you, Evans. Go tell everybody. I love telling people. I love sharing Jesus. But I can't do it for you. And I can't make you obedient. And I love doing it all the time. And I have found out that for every 10 people that I share with, one just busts wide open. It's like every 10. You're like, well, David, I don't want to go through all those 10. Man, it's those first 9 that prepare me for that 10th one. I'm going to tell you just straight up. Because I don't know what's happening when that 10th happens. I don't say anything special. I say pretty much the same kind of thing I kind of normally say. But then something happens. Something happens that just busts wide open in their life. And then I happen to be there. Not as some authoritative doctor over theology, like, I know all and I can answer all your questions. Not some weird mad scientist. But I find myself most often as a spectator. Because I realize that in those moments whenever God has used a donkey to speak, that when that truth from God happens and things start busting out, a lot of times I just sit and watch. A lot of times questions are happening. I don't know what to say. I just know the only prayer I got in my head, Lord, don't let me get in the way. Don't let me get in the way. Don't let me say something dumb, Lord. Don't let me get in the way. And watching this just open. What? Verses 10 and 11 remind us this depravity and blindness that thwart God's efforts to reach out to his own creation and still do. So those that are not sharing Jesus, what is it accustomed to? It is because of our blindness and because our depravity of sin, because we're sinful and we're blind people. Like something else really matters. The mission to tell everyone about Jesus is just a reminder that salvation is for everybody and not just a few. The Greek word there, idios, that's found in verse 10, translates into the word cosmos, which translates into the word world most often. Jesus is not just seeking a certain group of people like the Jewish people to see them come to Jesus. He's seeking everybody. It's not just some. It's all of us. That's why I feel it's my mandate, and it's your mandate, to tell everybody about Jesus. Well, David, what if they're going to be a part, they go down the Broadway? That's not my choice. That's not my answer. I don't know what they're going to do. I can tell you one thing. I'm going to kick and scream, persuade, cry, beg, plead, and do whatever I can to make sure they're not a part of that group. But are you? But are we? We are adopted into the family for mission. For mission. That's how you know our family. And that's how you know those that are not a part of our family. That's how you know the sheep from the goat, wheat from the tares. Those that are on mission, we ride on with Jesus. Those that are not, yeah, there's something going on there. Not sure what it is. Could be all kinds of things. But we are called to be on mission. My family and I had an unofficial meeting this week because we needed to be on the same page. Same exact page. It was an unofficial, it was just me and my wife, but we had this unofficial meeting. And the unofficial meeting was, what kind of items go down the drain of the sink? It's a good meeting to have. Every once in a while, you have to do this. I didn't expect to do this. I didn't know this meeting was going to occur last week. I would have had a PowerPoint presentation ready. I didn't have one ready. So we really just had to kind of go at it and just talk about it. And you're like, why did we have this meeting? Well, because I noticed whenever I went to the sink and I turned it on, it filled up. I'm like, that's not normal. There's something in the hole. there's something down in there. To which I grab a plunger. I'm not going to stick liquid plumber down there because it's going to make like a concrete block. You don't do that. I didn't have my snake. I'm just going to go in and grab a plunger. And whenever I go for the plunger and I get that good suction, you know that good suction, right? Yeah, that good suction. And I pump it once. Do you know the holes in the sink that are there so it doesn't overflow? Y'all know that those holes? Some of y'all like to stick your fingers in there whenever you're doing stuff. Not meant for your fingers. They're like overflow holes, right? So your whole bathroom or kitchen or whatever don't get flooded, right? Well, every time I pumped that thing, Fruit Loops jumped out of me. Pop, 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 pop. What in the world? I pump it again, more Fruit Loops, like that. I had like a whole entire bowl of Fruit Loops in the sink. Like, where do these Fruit Loops come from? Now, I'm not going to complain because, quite frankly, for a plumbing job, it smelled wonderful. Most of the time, they don't smell that good. This one smelled delightful. I wasn't eating it, though. I'm not that hungry. Not that hungry. So don't go there. Then I thought, well, Fruit Loops, they should go down a drain, right? I'm not sure who's putting Fruit Loops down the drain. You know, probably time for a family meeting, Drew. Probably, you know, let's put our heads together. No more cereal down the sink, especially like a bathroom sink. Kitchen sink, maybe, right? And so I'm like, well, it's not coming unclogged. So I get down underneath there, and I'm pulling pipe and stuff like that. And then all of a sudden, a couple things kind of fell out. A cap to a toothpaste, you know, yeah. That thing don't go down real easy. A bobby pin. That thing don't go down real easy. An entire stick of eyeliner. Just an entire stick. Just all there. All there. Yeah. I got to text my wife. I'm like, have you been missing something? Do you want to keep it? So we had this family meeting. Every once in a while, family meetings are necessary, right? So that we can get all on the same page with one another. Welcome to Sunday morning. Our family meeting, so we can get on the same page as one another. We're all called to be on mission together, to do the same thing. What's the same thing? It's called the fulfillment of the Great Commission, making disciples that make disciples that make disciples. If you're not creating disciples or improving disciples, you're not a part of the adopted family. We're adopted not only for mission, but we're adopted into the family of God for two actions and two reminders that you're never going to regret. Verse 12 says this, but as many received him, to them he gave the right to become children of God. The right to become children of God. Man, doesn't that just make your heart leap? Doesn't that just make your soul just kind of tingle just a little bit? Gave you the right. A right. Gave me the right. When I don't deserve rights. I'm not worthy of rights. And yet he gave me a right. To be his child, of all the children of the world, to be his child, even of those who believe in his name. The two reminders that we see, the first reminder is that the Lord is salvation. We see this believe in him three times in the Gospel of John. John chapter 1, chapter 2, and chapter 3. He uses this verbiage. But this verbiage goes and points all the way back to Exodus. Exodus chapter 3, verses 14 and 15. It says, the Lord is our salvation. Just a reminder, the very beginning of John to us, that the Lord is our salvation, that we're adopted into this family to live in such a way that the Lord is our salvation, not something else. That when we have an issue, it's the Lord that saves us. And I believe in a capital letter S, salvation, salvation of away from sin and the eternal salvation, but I also believe in a lowercase salvation S. Man, we just all need salvations from something about every week. About every day, if you will. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Just about every day, something just comes into our life where we're just like, man, Lord, I just need a little bit of help. Anybody? Just shake your head, because obviously I can't understand you with a mask on. Just, yeah, bob it. Bob it like you're in a concert. There you go. All right, I got you. The other thing that this passage reminds us of is that life is not totally hopeless. It's not totally hopeless. When you've had a month, a week, year, or whatever, and you're like, ah, if this 2020 can just go away. Verse 12, it says, because some people did receive him. Some people did receive him. It's not totally hopeless. There's effect being made. You go out and you share Jesus with 10 people, and only one makes a decision. You're like, man, am I really doing any good? Am I really doing anything that really matters in this world? The seed that you're sowing in all those lives, you have no idea how those things are going to root and blossom. And I've heard from people that have come back years ago, years and years. People from high school have called me back and said, listen, man, I am giving my life to Jesus. I'm being baptized. I had a good friend all the way from kindergarten call me 2 years ago and said, I'm going to get baptized. I live now in Georgia. But what they're telling me, I wanted to make sure it was right. And you were the one person in my mind that I knew I can completely trust because you kept on and on and on telling me about Jesus. And I trust you. As a grown man, he and then his little boy got baptized somewhere in Georgia. I don't know where it was, but it was awesome. Life is not totally hopeless. But we also not only see these two reminders, but we see two actions. That when we live as children of God, there are two actions that ultimately have taken place. Number one, the action from us, our man's action, that we are to receive and believe. We're to repent and surrender our life to him. That believe, when you see that, that's not just a head knowledge like intellectual assent. Because the Greek word pistuo literally means a surrender. It's a life acceptance and a life following type of belief. But the second action that we see here is that God's action is to give them the power to become the sons of God. He gives them the power. Have you ever hit a situation where you just needed a little extra power? You know you didn't have any more oomph. You know you didn't have any more energy. And you've kind of probably come to your wits' end and you just need just a little. When you're an adopted son or daughter of God, this power that he delivers, pardon my grammar, but it ain't just a little. It's a fueling and an empowering that can push you and push you, mold you, sustain you on and on and on through whatever trial and tribulation you've got. But listen, if you don't want to be on mission with him, you're not going to have this power. It's for the adopted sons and daughters of God. It's not for those that are playing the game. It's not for those that, man, I can talk it. Man, I can look it. But I'm sure enough not going to act like it. My nature is not going to change. I'm still going to be me, doing what I want to do. If that's who you are, you don't have that power to sustain and push and fuel you. In the great words of the philosopher Bobby Boucher, tackling fuel. Tackling fuel. Thank you for laughing. It wasn't real funny, but thank you. Quite frankly, we're not that deserving of it. Adoption gave to them right, refers to a legitimate entitlement to the position of children of God. None of us was naturally a child of God. We were naturally children of wrath and disobedience, condemned apart from Christ. So where are you at? Just because you call yourself and you've embraced the title, is that your nature? You know the nature. You know who you are. You know how you act. Do you act like a child of wrath and disobedience? Only wanting power to control and dictate to other people? Or are you truly a child of God? A son and daughter of obedience and grace? One that loves to tell the story. Oh, loves to tell the story of a Savior that came from glory. Oh, man. Jason's not here right now. I'm not going to get off into singing that song. He'll never leave again. Justin earlier talked about friendly competition with Operation Christmas Child. And this past week, I have found myself in, I see you crossing your arms. You know what's happening. I found myself in competition with maybe a Sunday school group because they posted something on Facebook saying that they need to hit a certain goal, which it was my job to let them know they're not going to hit that goal. They're going to fail. Just fail. Even the way the Facebook posts were, it's just not going to work. No, y'all, although you hit like 16 last year, I'm just telling you, you're not going to do it. I don't know what Sunday school class particular it is. I don't recall. I know the Lindos are a part of it. I don't know which one it is, but I had to share with them, you're just not going to hit 16 boxes this year, guys, all right? And I hate to tell you, it's just not going to happen. I mean, if you hit 20, if you just happen to bring about 20 guys, if you're in the Sunday school class, let me just verbally tell you, if you can hit 20, which I don't think you can choose, like, you know, I don't wear ties, but you can choose whatever tie you want me to wear that Sunday, all right? There you go. You get a win. I just don't think you're going to do it. You might hit 8. Yeah. I mean, that's just kind of the tone of the Facebook message I was reading. It just seemed like it just drenched with failure. Just failure. And like, we're not going to do this well. And then they're like, oh, listen, if we get 20, then we need to pick out your jacket and color your hair. No, listen. Y'all getting way above yourself. Way above yourself, all right? So here it is. If this Sunday school group, whoever it is, ask the Lindahls, they're a part of it. So, all right, so whoever it is, who's a leader? I see you, Ricky Kreisel. I see you, Ricky Kreisel. Now I know. They done called you out in the middle of church, sir. Ricky Kreisel, if your group, if y'all can hit like, I don't know, 20, yeah, a tie. Yeah, 200, I'll let you pick a jacket out, whatever. Just as long as it ain't solid gold. I can't afford that, man. I'm not going to be that guy, all right? Pink. Ugh. Oh, here's a challenge. I just don't think you do it anyway. So go on. If you can hit 200, you get a jacket, whatever. And if you can do what was it, 750, the whole goal? Yeah, whatever color hair you want. I really don't think you're going there. Sorry. I don't think you can. I hear somebody talking. I can't understand, though. I hear something happening. So as a family, why do we have these competitions? What's going on? Because quite frankly, here's the thing. Here's the reality of it all. If Ricky's group, aka Lindell's group, if they fail, we fail. Because if their group fails and everybody else kind of does kind of their normal, we won't be able to succeed and do what God has called us to do. If they fail, we fail. If they fail and you fail, we all fail. We need everybody upon this boat succeeding, burning after the goals, going after these things and doing what God has called us to do. Because church is just like a big old body of water. When it rises, we all should rise with it. And if we're not, we're doing something terribly, terribly wrong. We're not only adopted in the family of God for mission and also to be reminded of these two reminders and these two actions, but also we're adopted into the family of God while we don't even earn it and while we don't even deserve it. And let me tell you something. If you live like you're adopted in the family of God, when you've not deserved it or earned it, you'll never, ever regret it. In verse 13, who were born, not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. We see that the references of adoption not pertaining to God found in the Bible, like in Exodus 2, Pharaoh's daughter adopting Moses. We see in Esther chapter 2, verses 7 and 15, Mordecai adopting Esther. So we see these instances in the Bible. But here what John is talking about is God adopting you and I as children, spiritually, physically, and all about who we are as his children. Jameson Fawcett Brown talks to us about how we're to act. How we're to act as adopted sons and daughters. They say this, a sonship or daughtership, therefore not of mere title and privilege, but of nature. The soul being made conscious of the vital capacities, perceptions, and emotions of a child of God before the unknown. Before unknown. So how can you tell if you're right on with the Lord? Do you have his emotions? Do you have his perceptions? Are you living within his capabilities? Those are three ways that you know that you're a part of the family of God. If you don't think like him, if you don't feel like him, and you're definitely not living within his capabilities, you, my friend, have missed the whole point of it all. We are capable. Not with our capability, but his capability, which I believe that he can save our entire county from an eternity in hell. And he can see all of Robertson County come to Jesus Christ. That's why we've got such a vision that's bigger than us to make it hard to go to hell from Robertson County. It's bigger than us because he has that capability. But also in the same mindset, do you have his mindset? Do you have his perception on things? Do you see people the way that he sees people? Or even the emotion of God? Do you feel about people the way that he feels about them? If you don't, that's a great spiritual check. I can't tell if you do or not. And people around you can't tell or not. That's a good spiritual check for you. Does your heart beat like his heartbeat? Does your mind tick like his ticks? And are you really seeing things in your life that go way beyond your capability? If you do, then there is proof in your life that there has been an adoption. Whenever I study for sermons, I have groups of books that I go through, library and stuff like that I go through. I study the Bible first, and I go through those books, and I get right back to the Bible, and I study the original language and stuff like that, so I know kind of what's happening, and I can understand even better. But every once in a while, I have a little bit of time at the end of my study each week, and I'm like, well, I'm going to go to the World Wide Webs, and I'm going to see what they have to say about all this. I'm going to just kind of see if I can find something out there. And I found a guy that I read, John Piper, had 8 aspects of adoption. And so I'm glad that I did this. But he has 8 aspects of adoption. Number one, adoption was for God and is for us costly. Costly. Your adoption's expensive. What God gave up, what God gave to your adoption, cost him a lot, according to Galatians 4:4-5. The second thing adoption did for God and does for us involved the legal status of a child. Involved the legal status. So it's official, very official, that you are part of God's kingdom, according to Galatians 4:6. The third thing that we notice is adoption was blessed and is blessed with God's pouring out a spirit of sonship. So he pours his spirit into your life, according to Romans 8:15-16. The fourth aspect, adoption was for God and is for us, marked by a moral transformation through his spirit. You will have a different ethical code, and more than likely a different ethical code than the world. There's no sense in us saying, well, let's try to match our ethical code. And no, we match the Savior's ethical code. Your morality is different because according to Romans 8:14, it's been transformed. Fifthly, adoption brought us and brings our children the rights of being heirs to the Father. Being heirs, as we've already talked about, Galatians 4:7. Number 6, adoption was for God and is for us seriously planned. Seriously planned. According to Ephesians 1:4-6, it didn't just happen. It didn't just happen by chance. There's a lot of thought, a lot of effort, a lot of time that has went into your salvation and other people's salvation too. That's why whenever I get to that 10th one, whenever I'm sharing faith, and it just all comes crashing in on their life, sometimes I'm not too terribly surprised because I'm not the only one in that picture at all by any stretch of the imagination. There's been a life of investment, a life of seeds poured into this person's life that when I come to the plate, man, I'm just ultimately just a spectator. Don't get in the way, Evans. Let God move right now in this person's life. 7, adoption was for God and is often now for us from very bad situations. Ephesians 2:3 says, we were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind. Adoption is for us from very bad situations. And the 8th one, adoption meant for all Christians and means for Christian parents that we suffer now and experience glory later. If you're experiencing glory now and no suffering, everything's mixed up with you. Everything's backward. Everything's in the wrong direction because we suffer now and we glorify later, according to Romans chapter 8, verses 22-23. I think I want you to notice about verse 13 is this. There's a threefold negative assertion. Look in verse 13. Look in verse 13. Who were born, number 1, not of blood, number 2, nor the will of flesh, number 3, nor of the will of man. Just a reminder, 3 ways to say it. Just a reminder that you and I did not manufacture this salvation, but there has been a supernatural birth. A supernatural birth that it wasn't because of what I've done or what I could do, but because of the supernatural birth. Now, how do we know about that supernatural birth? Because you see the last part of verse 13? But of God. But of God. Do you have any of those kind of situations in your life where you didn't know how it really just all came together? It's but of God, that he moved in such a way that it's incomprehensible. That you don't know how to make heads nor tails of it. You just know something is happening. Because it wasn't by flesh or mind or whatever you've got, but of God. You may be sitting in a situation now where that might be where you need this supernatural move in your life. You need a but of God because you have expressed all that you've expressed. You've done all that you've done. You've spent all that you've spent, and it's still more and more frustrating, more and more hard work, and you can't get out of it, and you're just begging God and pleading with Him, please, God, move. But of God moves in your life. And you're like, where did that come from? How did that happen? It just comes across sometimes in a way that you are least expecting it. And you know why? Because we're not even looking in that direction sometimes. Because we're looking at the problem. We're looking at the waves. We're looking at the issue. And then all of a sudden, He sweeps across our life like a majestic, mighty whirlwind. With a supernatural moment. That's what salvation is. And brothers and sisters, I'm here to tell you that He moves like that, not only in the moment of salvation in your life, but through your life, on and on and on. Why? For His glory and His glory alone. He wants things in your life to be incomprehensible at times. Why? So we only explain like, I don't know, it's God moving in my life. Do you have those in your life? Do you need those in your life? God moves through the adopted children, through Christ-filled believers, those that repent and surrender to Him in such a way that you just don't get it. A few years ago, I had this family that was coming to a church, and they connected with me. He would bring his wife, and he would just bail, and he was a real big, just brute guy, you know, motorcycle club, like just hard, hard guy. And he never really did me sideways or anything, but I could tell, boy, if you got on his wrong side, man, he'd be a tough guy to just kind of deal with. And that was his persona. That's what he really loved and stuff like that. And she was just heartbroken. She was just terribly heartbroken about the salvation of her husband. And so she invited me over, just me to come over and right on the border of Kentucky to go and have dinner with him, because he's like, yeah, dude, come to my house and stuff, and seemed like he was okay with me and friendly with me and stuff like that. But even in that meeting and stuff, and even in that spaghetti dinner, boy, I love spaghetti. That was a good night. That spaghetti dinner, he was just so hard-nosed. He was just kind of shock and awe. You know, he just kind of, and then all of a sudden, and I remember this, I remember the scene, I remember the carpet, I remember the kitchen, I remember everything. It was just like it was all playing out, and everything just was pausing except for him. And I was just looking around, and I was taking all this stuff in. It was like one of those movie moments in my head. Like, I remember all the details, the smell, the leftover food, and just all that kind of stuff. And he just got up, and he stood up. He said, yeah. And dude walked into the kitchen. We're kind of in this dining area, and he walked into the kitchen. He dragging a chair, and I'm looking like, what is he doing? And he just slams it on the ground, and he sits down. He says, David, put your hands on me. I don't know what this means. I don't know what's going on. I just know I've got years of karate, and if it's about to go down, baby, it's about to go down. I mean, I'll fight for Jesus any day. I'm waiting for that meeting, right? You know, I ain't smart enough some days, but baby, I'm waiting for that fight. But I thought, okay, I'm going to put my hands on him. I'm going to see where this goes. I thought he was going to flip me and punch me or knife me. I said, I was going to fight for Jesus. But I put my hands on him, and he just breaks. The complete wall of China that this man is and was just breaks. And God was moving. Like, there are things I shared, but guys, I'm going to tell you, I didn't share anything prolific. It wasn't intelligent at all. Just faithful, man, just faithful. Just pouring seeds into his wife and in his life. Just kept doing it and kept doing it. And it just broke right then. And dude just radically, I've not seen too many radical, but radically gave his life to Christ. Hasn't turned back since. But oh my goodness, in that moment, I couldn't explain it. I can't explain it. And I realized I'm nothing more than a spectator. I'm nothing more than a spectator. But I tell you what, there's nothing else that I want to be in this world, is a spectator to God moving, and God moving in some magical, awesome, big, huge, supernatural kind of ways. But of God, they happen. I'm telling you, they happen. And if you're not adopted, if you're not repentant, and you're not surrendered, you're not going to see it. You're not going to be a part of it. And what a sad life it'll be, because you're going to miss this whole Christianity, this whole church thing away. You're just going to miss it, because when he moves, but of God, woo, I'm telling you, he moves in mighty, mighty ways. And he's here, I promise you, he's here to move in your life. He's here to let your family know, to let your friends know, to let your coworkers know. He loves them. He loves the mess out of them. And he's wanting to move. And he wants you, as a Christ-filled believer, to be a vehicle of obedience and faithfulness, to let the people around you know that he has a mighty, mighty love, but of God. How many of us today need that kind of movement, need that kind of moment, need that kind of experience in our life? Because, you know, we ain't got no more. We ain't got no more. We ain't got no more push. And we've got to have the Lord move. Be adopted by him. Repent. Surrender your life to him. He loves you. He loves the mess out of you. And if you've done it once and you ain't seen it, you did it wrong. Do it again. Make it right. And he'll move. But of God, he wants to move for you, for his glory. He loves you so much. He loves you. And he wants you to surrender to him today. With every head bowed and eye closed, with every head bowed and eye closed, I'd like to ask musicians to come forward. Today, you may be here, and this may not be your church family, your church home, but let me ask you, do you want a church family? Do you want to be adopted into something here earthly that you're like, man, I can't do this on my own. I got to link arms. Will you adopt me into your family? I want to be a part. Well, we're going to pray. And what I'm going to ask of you, would you move? Just come to me and let me know your intentions. That, man, I want to be a member of this church. I want to be right here in this church. Maybe you're here and you realize, and pardon my grammar, but you ain't acting like part of the family. And you know you might be keeping your ministry, your family, your church back because you're not doing it. You're acting like that family member that none of us want to see on Thanksgiving. And people struggle because they know there's better in you. But today I want to ask if you would repent of your sins and surrender your life anew to God. And finally, maybe you're here because, or maybe you're here and you've never repented of your sins. You've never surrendered your life to Jesus. You've never been baptized. And you would like to be a part, number one, of God's family. We're not going to start here, but you want to be a part of God's family. And then you could be a part of this Springfield Baptist family. But man, you want to be a part of God's family. I want you to come and move. I'm going to have my mask on. So if you want to come and let me know that you want to give your life to Christ, you come on. If you want to come up here to this altar and socially distance and pray for other people that you know, I want you to come on. If you want to be a part of this faith family, you come on. This is your time, your invitation. Father, we love you. God, thank you for all that you've given to us. God, thank you for this day. God, I ask that you move within us, move around us, use us for the glorification of your kingdom. And God, if there are people here that don't know you, please, Lord, let this be the day. God, let it be right now that they do not leave this place without knowing and loving you. God, if there's somebody here that is known as a Christian, God, but their act ain't together, they're more about self than they are the Savior, God, we ask that you break them. Break them, Lord. God, and put them back together right. Because they ain't got all things put together right now, Lord. Please. And Lord, if there's somebody here that needs a family to do life with, and they're not in a church right now, God, persuade them, Lord, that today's the day to have a church family right here, right now. Lord, we love you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. As we all stand and sing this song of invitation, this is your time and your invitation.
Amazing grace is how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found.
good to see all of you here today. Thank you for Mitchell and the team for stepping in and leading us today. Will y'all give them a round of applause? Just thank you. Thank you, Bridget. Thank you, Drew. Thank you, guys. Guys, let me remind you, just a couple of announcements. We've got the Thanksgiving meal that we do on Thanksgiving. If you can donate to that, so that way we're COVID-friendly, hands-off kind of friendly, and just have very few hands that are a part, very safe, capable hands that are doing our meals for Thanksgiving. November the 22nd, we've got a community Thanksgiving service right here. Let me tell you the churches so far that are a part of it. It's going to be us. It's going to be North Springfield. Brother Michael Smith will be delivering our message. We also have Methodist Church, Springfield Methodist Church. They led the message last year with Dr. Jason Wilkerson. And so we also have City of Faith with Brother Robert Gardner that's coming. And and he's asked me if they can have that their part would be a moment. So we're going to have us a moment from their from one of their teams. And it's going to be good. I'm going to tell you, you don't want to miss this Thanksgiving community service because you're not going to forget about this one. It's going to be good when all of God's children come together and we celebrate and celebrate and celebrate. So also on the OCC, just make sure you join up with your Sunday school class and try to beat Ricky Kreisel's class because they're going to need all the help they can get. I don't think they can pull theirs together. So do all that. Let's pray and then we'll get out of here. Father, we love you. And God, I thank you for all that you've given to us. God, thank you for this day and this moment. God, I ask that you encourage us. And God, also today, give us opportunity to meet someone that we can tell about your grace and love. And Lord, let us not be sheepish. God, let us not shy away. But God, let us step into that moment, speak into that moment, and just stand up for you in that moment in a loving, kind, non-Bible-thumping kind of way to where we can express your love in a wonderful way to somebody that may be broken. God, please send somebody into each and every one of our lives so we can get our mission on. We love you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. You are dismissed.